Hello and welcome back, everybody. We're here in the central on the central stage. Reina and Paul, thank you very much for an interesting interview. I think we got a good idea of what the similarities are between science and diplomacy with regard to cultural changes, and also the role that good leadership plays in realizing such a process. I have the honor to present three, or at least I should say four beautiful ladies at this table. On my right, Rianne Letschert, still from the first session. On my left, Annemijn Alga from Young Science in Transition. Besides Annemijn, Rosanne Anholt from the Dutch PhD Network. PNN, Promovendi Netwerk Nederland, and Hanneke Hulst from the Young Academy. Guys, you're the young scientists of our days. Why is recognition and rewards important? What needs to change in academia?
So I'll start on behalf of Young Science in Transition. I think we've already heard quite a bit this morning. You were already saying that it's very important that young academics get the opportunity to form their own profile and to make their own choices. And I think that it's great to see that professors are already being evaluated on the basis, so no longer being evaluated on the basis of an age index or output. But we should not forget that in many institutions, a lot of PhDs or young researchers are still being evaluated on the basis of output. So we should really get rid of the output metrics everywhere, also lower in the hierarchy.
Yeah. So we need to translate that all through the different layers of university. Hanneke, what would you need to be rid of?
Well, I think the idea that there is the five-legged sheep, or that there is everyone has to be similar. I think the diversification is very important because there are different roles in academia, and to make sure that we can have these roles with high quality, we cannot ask everyone to do everything. So I think that is what the Young Academy really wants to see changed.
To have a diversification of roles.
Yeah, so really being a good teacher, but then not having to excel in research at the same time, because you simply cannot do everything. And I think there are people that think they can do everything, but in fact you should wonder what is there have to be sacrifices if you do outreach and you have to supervise PhD students. Then perhaps your supervision is a little bit less dedicated because you have other things that you have to focus on. And I think making very clear what your profile is that you can excel in that particular part. And then looking as science as a system, if you do it together, we can have high quality on all levels. And I think that is really important.
Okay, Rosanne, how does the PhD network think about this?
Well, in addition to what has already been said, I'm hoping, or we're hoping very much, that this recognition and awards movement will also make science or academia a nicer place to work at. Mm-hmm. And what we see now is that there's such a competitive environment, but competitive in quite a toxic sense, that I think that a lot of high quality researchers who are doing their PhD at the moment actually think like, you know what? I'm not going to do this. This is not for me. And I think we're losing a lot of talent that way.
And are there also concerns from your community? Because you're the population that is in the middle of this transition. So I can also imagine there are some concerns you would like to share with the audience and with us.
Yeah, absolutely. So two questions that are living in our community at the moment is, first of all, what is recognition and awards? When we talk to our members, who are not individual PhD candidates, but representatives at the different universities and medical centers, a lot of them are not yet involved in this in these discussions, whether at national or local university level. So I feel like that is really important. And also what Annemijn has also said is that we are still being evaluated really on the basis of, you know, how many articles have you published or how many chapters does your dissertation have, as well as did you make the 30 credits that you have to do. But we do so much more than that. You know, a lot of PhD candidates are doing teaching, they're developing courses, they're doing societal impact, they're doing management tasks. So the second question is also, how can we measure that? You know, if we need to measure that, how can we measure quality rather than quantity in order to keep these talented people with us?
Yeah, so you're also saying that the whole assessment of the PhD trajectory during the years, but also at the end, should be revised, because now you're being assessed at the end on the basis of your manuscript.
Yeah.
And if we want to really implement the principles of the program also for PhDs, then that should really be changed. And I think we haven't given that enough attention yet. So we are actually discussing mostly after the PhD has been obtained. And I think we need to talk also with the steering group that it has to start from the moment you enter a PhD track.
Absolutely, because that assessment is for now still really traditional, and it looks at the end product and not necessarily at the entire process you go through in a trajectory.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So, Hanneke, from the Young Academy, you came up with a report that is called "Goed voorbeeld doet volgen" in Dutch. What is that? What does that report say? What is in that?
Well, we were really thinking, like, if we want to make the transition to a new reward and recognition system, are there examples out there? Because I think you can learn from examples. And we found them. So we interviewed 8 persons with a very, I think a very nice route that they followed. And, for example, looking at the University of Ghent, there it seems to be a lot less... how do you say it? Conditional. So it is unconditional. So you're an excellent scientist. We want to have you in our university. And rather than to see if you are successful in what you achieve, if you have a year that it doesn't go that well, you have a support system that looks like, why didn't you manage to have success in that area that you anticipated?
Yeah.
And then you get support to actually achieve it next year. So it's also taking into account that within the contracts of a few years, that sometimes you have a year that is not going so well. And then to have unconditional support from a support system that consists of your peers, but also people that are independent from your research field, have you actually develop skills and support that you can do what you have to do. And I think that is... creating a safe environment. And I think that was one of the examples that we really felt like if you can have such a setup, that can also make people get the best out of themselves and the best for the system, because I think that is in the end what you want. You don't want people that are just running around to get all the numbers and the metrics, but the whole story needs to fit. And that also means that if you have a bad year, that doesn't mean you're not a good scientist anymore.
Exactly.
But the Young Academy is known to be a network of very high qualified researchers, top scientists. So what are you changing in your own selection procedure in order to get a more diverse group of academics that we are looking for?
Well, at least we actually also got rid of the metric. So it's really looking at the narrative that we implemented, and also to really keep an open mind, for example, for people that have a more educational profile. So old school, we are more like the scientists, but we're really like, okay, we have to look for other talents because there is more talent out there. So we are at least aware, open-minded, and we changed a little bit of how we did the selection of
important. That's important. Annemij, now you represent the Young Science in Transition group, and I think maybe for our audience it's also good that you explain a little bit what your objectives are.
Yes.
And also from your perspective, what are the concerns? Because we are of course very positive about everything that's happening, but we're also not naive, and we also want to improve. So. Can you answer both questions?
Yeah, I'll give a short introduction on who Young Science in Transition is. So we're a group of early career researchers at the UMC Utrecht, ranging from PhD candidates to associate professors, all from different disciplines within the UMC. Well, I should say also now outside the UMC, because we're expanding.
Good.
And so on a yearly basis, we organize various mini symposia on themes like open science, team science, and of course, recognition and rewards. And our goal is to eventually come up with concrete actions for early career researchers that we can actually use in our daily practices. And Rian, you were already saying it's important that we start evaluating PhDs in a different way. And I'm proud to say that's one of our concrete actions, that we've already developed a new evaluation system for PhDs.
What does that look like, the new
system? So basically, my own experience was that I was still having to fill out a word form every year, which had three first questions. How many articles did you publish last year? How many abstracts? How many prizes did you get? And especially when you're when you're in your first years, the answer is going to be 0, 0, 0. And it's not that you haven't developed any skills. So we decided to get rid of all these questions.
Very demotivating.
Then we just introduced an open question asking the PhD candidate, so what are your two best accomplishments? And of course, this can still be an article because we shouldn't be getting rid of the articles in total. But it can also be something else, for example, dealing with a difficult situation within your PhD team and then solving it or organizing an event. Yeah. So I guess this really sets the tone, because if you teach PhD students to count articles, they'll probably keep counting articles. But if you give them the opportunity to be rewarded in a different way, they can open their eyes for different talents and different career paths in the future. So, and then now I notice that it's so hard work to really implement such a new strategy.
Yeah.
We started local at one PhD school, and now we're moving from one PhD school to the next. But eventually, we want to work together with the recognition and reward committee and introduce it everywhere.
Yeah, that would be great. I'm thinking, why could you tell us, is it so bad to work with metrics? Why do we want to get rid of metrics?
Well, I should correct you, Jeroen. I don't think we should get rid of metrics totally. Probably the answer is in the middle. Articles will always be important. But it's good to realize that researchers can also have other skills which are difficult to count or evaluate, for example. Well, as a doctor, how do you grade empathy? That's a difficult word, actually. Some skills are perhaps you can tell a story about it, but you cannot grade it.
Right. I was actually, somebody said to me, you as a PI, so me as a PI, you shouldn't be so happy about your article in Brain. Brain is a journal in our field that has a high impact factor. And I said, well, I can still be happy about a publication in Brain as long as I don't automatically assume that that makes me a great scientist. You know, it's part of a story. It's part of a story that you're building. And sometimes there is a publication in Brain. Sometimes there is, a publication in a much lower impact journal that is really good for patients. So we need to have, again, that diversification, I think.
And can I add something? Sure, because I think it is a cultural change. You know, like you were also raised in the system that Brain was fantastic. So we all have that tendency to say, well, we publish in Brain, so this is great. And if you publish in a lower impact journal, that you're not sharing it. So I think it's really something that the whole system, bottom up, top down, we have to do this together. And I think it's great if someone says, hey, why are you so happy about this Brain paper? And shouldn't you be also happy about the other to open that discussion?
Because
I think it's the cultural change that needs to happen on all from the PhD students until the people that are the bosses of the universities, because we have to do it all together. And I think cultural change takes time, but I think talking about it and also pointing each other towards, hey, you're making that mistake, or hey, you're doing this, why are you doing this? And then hear the story behind it, because obviously you can still be proud of your Brain article, and you should be able to.
It's the conversation that matters, right? It's the conversation, yeah.
Yeah, and also not only you refer now to an example of a high impact journal and maybe a lower that already gives a certain ranking, of course. But what I always missed when I was your age is that I could also invest time in improving my educational skills or my educational format. And I never took the time for that because I knew, well, in the end of the year, I will only be evaluated for my research and for my grants, and the education is just a minor thing. And I really miss that. And I think that's also what we really would like to see change, that the other tasks that we have to do at a university that are really valuable also get the acknowledgement that they deserve, so that you will also improve there and innovate, which we do not really do as much as in the research domain. But I think if we talk about this cultural change, that's we're also a little bit old already, yeah? We need people like you and the communities that you represent to very much steer this dialogue and to talk about it with the people in leadership positions, because they're also still there and they need to be convinced that this is here to stay. And do you maybe have any ideas for us, or that you're already developing in your own communities, how you can shout out louder in the coming year? Because we're looking back to some extent, but we also want to move, definitely Jeroen and I, we really want to move faster. So what can you do? Or what will you do? Maybe start with you?
Yeah, sure. So I think, first of all, I think really that the involvement of local PhD councils is really important, because they will be the next generation of researchers, and to also to invite them to reflect on what will this mean for our trajectories and for the assessment of our trajectories. That you know, we need to raise awareness that numbers eventually do not tell a whole story, right? So it's really about what is behind those numbers. I think one of the concerns that we have also is that you know, we are now being assessed on, for example, number of articles or number of chapters that a PhD dissertation has. But what if, you know, recognition and awards will translate into, okay, but we have another list of 30 criteria that we have fulfill. We also have to write so many blogs. We have to do so many media performances. Yeah, you know, we have to do so many courses or teach so many courses. And that is really kind of like the pitfalls, I think, that we have to, see to...
see to it that it doesn't become a new system of ticking boxes, right?
Exactly.
And that's workload.
Yeah, that's even more heavier than the one we have.
Exactly. For PhDs, it would be really great, and I'm going to do that myself, because if you want to start change, you should start yourself, that instead of writing 5 articles for my thesis, I'm going to write 3, and I'm going to add an extra chapter on my work for Young Science in Transition, because that's also me as a PhD.
Exactly. Yeah.
I want to be involved in my own future.
Yeah, that's very important. But it's what you are saying. I had a nice discussion with Paul Bozuli yesterday, who was just in the previous session, that we also need to talk when, for instance, if you talk about the combination of the different tasks, when that will apply. Is that already at the PhD level? Is it at the associate professor level or assistant professor level? In Utrecht, they're currently discussing to maybe start that at the associate professor level.
Yeah.
I'm not so much in favor yet, because I do think that developing yourself as a PhD in the broad domains that the university work actually entails is very important.
Absolutely.
And you just said after PhD, you are the next generation researchers. No, you're the next generation academics. And an academic does much more than only research. But in our mind, it's already, we'll become the researchers. So we limit it already to that domain.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and I think in that regard also, it's important to go to a more mentoring system. So you're also, as a PhD supervisor, mentoring your PhDs already in what they're good at. So, but it will be a continuous process even after assistant or associate professor. Yeah. Having a mentor that really looks for what is your skill that's different than mine, and how can you then develop?
I think that's very important, and that's leadership again, right?
And as well as career guidance, because we see that quite a small percentage, I think it's less than half of PhD candidates, I think it's around 40%, get some career guidance from their institution. Yeah. So I think that is also really important to find out, where do you want to develop yourself? In what in what kind of direction do you want to do that?
Exactly.
So it's indeed mentoring, but also more general career guidance.
Let's have a look at some questions from the audience. Kim.
Thank you, Jeroen. Yeah, there was also something which was mentioned in the chat. So we need open-minded supervisors that give honest feedback. So, but there was also this question from Benjamin LaRuth. I hope I pronounce your name correctly. It can be difficult for young academics to know what they want or can in their careers. Which resources will be made available to guide them in the right direction?
That's a good question. Is it something, Annemijn, you could answer?
Maybe I could. So one thing I could say is that in the new evaluation method we have developed, we've introduced a PhD competence model, which is a self-evaluation tool by which you can self-evaluate yourself in various research competences. Mm-hmm. And now we say that on the basis of these competences, you can formulate goals for yourself. Where do you want to go? How do you want to grow? And we think it's important that you have a mentor or people to go to within your PhD program that can help you on your path so that you can, exactly what Roseanne is already saying, that perhaps you don't want to stay in academia. That's nothing wrong with that. No. But perhaps you do when you want a certain profile. But so I think it's important that you know yourself very well and make the right choices. And
again, that mentor, right? The importance of a mentor, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and maybe also trainings. I think that some universities have cut on the resources available for PhDs and early career researchers to go to trainings, modules on personal development, intervention with peers. Now, if we are not willing to invest in those modules, then I think we're also not living up to our objective that we're discussing here. Yeah. So that's for university management to see that is very important, that these investments become available again.
Yeah. Kim, hit us with another one.
Yeah, that's one. It's actually a question from the beginning of your talk, from Marjolein Vloothuis. What is your opinion about tenure tracks? So a lot of universities have tenure track systems. What's your opinion about these tenure tracks possibilities?
Yeah. Annika, perhaps that is a situation. So tenure tracks is a lot of that is going on in the Young Academy, I guess.
Yeah, I'm sort of now struggling with what's the Young Academy thinking? What am I thinking? I think in the end it is all if it goes hand in hand. So you make. I don't think there's anything wrong per se with tenure tracks as long as it's not a conditional thing. So if you really think this person is ready to grow on the academic ladder, and you have the guidance and to the support to reach your goal, I think it's okay. And also, I think in the end, we also have limited spots available. So I think that's also something we have to face. So it's not that we can say everybody is going to be professor at some point. Yeah. So in that sense, I think we have to be realistic as well. But I think the way how you organize these tenure tracks, that can be improved, I guess.
It could be an important platform for mentoring. Right, so a tenure track can be an opportunity for you to choose a mentor who kind of guides you through the process.
Yeah, and also then looking at Ghent, for example, they have independent people outside the field as a mentor, and I think that can really add. Also, what I hear is that some people are afraid that if you lose the metrics, that you get more like, if I like you, then I'll make sure that you make it. But having an independent person also observing your path and how you develop, that can also help the whole system to be more established.
I think. And I think that the criteria on the basis of which you're being evaluated during the track should also live up to the recognition and rewards ambitions. Yeah. Otherwise, it will remain the same.
No, and it should be different for every person. It's a different tenure track based on your skills and your strong points.
Liana, in your experience as a rector, are tenure tracks doing what they should do, namely kind of giving academicians guidance in their career?
Well, we implemented it, I think, now 2.5 years ago, so it's too early to evaluate. But what we did do is to base the criteria on recognition and reward that of course. Yeah. So that means also looking at what do you do for the team? Have you contributed to a collective objective instead of only to your individual career? That's now part of one of the assessment criteria. And we've also included the evaluation by an independent committee. So not your faculty department head, because then you get all the subjectiveness in the evaluation. But it just started, so it's too soon. And we also said you get 10 years, but it doesn't mean that you have to wait for the 10 years to get your permanent contract. If after 3 years it's totally visible that you should become a permanent associate or assistant professor, you already get it earlier. Mm. But the stress to do it within a very short time limit is also out, because you have 10 years the time. And that's also good if you want to have also other things in life, such as a family, or you have care that you need to take care of in your home situation. Mm-hmm. And that's there. Well, I that's hear nice. Actually yeah. kind already nice results that staff feel that it's also not so much pressure that you have to do it in a very short time period.
Yeah. It's a little bit that unconditional thing. Yeah. We believe in you, and you get 10 years to sure? combine.
It can also be earlier. Right?
Yeah. So if you're.
You can choose then. Do I want to have the quick path, or do I indeed want to have some time also for my young children, for instance?
I have a related question here from Selma de Ridder. We are talking a lot about training and mentoring. However, that requires time that is not necessarily allocated to it. How do we address that?
But that's the academic citizenship part. And that also falls under the leadership domain within our position paper. So we say if you engage in those roles, whether you call it academic citizenship or you name it, in Maastricht we call it academic citizenship, you should be rewarded for that, because it does cost time, and then you should also be acknowledged, and you should also be sometimes trained for that, because not everyone is able to be a good mentor. Mm. So it's absolutely important.
And then some people in the audience see that in these recognition and rewards committees we have now at all Dutch universities and at the funders and research institutes, that there are not so many young scientists involved in these committees. Mm. I know at several universities they are, but at some they aren't.
Then I would knock on the door of those committees and rectors and say, hey, we want to be involved.
And look at us sitting here, Rosanne, Hanneke, okay. and myself. We're representing three great young initiatives, and we're sitting here. That's great. And if we join forces and knock on the doors, we're invited. And at the Recognition and Rewards Committee in Utrecht, they're following our example, and that's great.
I like it. Break down some doors.
We need like this, because this mud layer in the middle, it's getting thinner. Yeah. Both sides pushes.
Yeah, and we don't have to wait for an invitation. We should just start changing
our stuff. Definitely.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah, I agree totally.
Exactly.
Yeah.
All right, hit us with another one. Let's see if we have more questions from the audience.
What's meant by unconditional tenure tracks?
Right. What did you mean, Hanna?
Well, I meant that obviously there is a conditional part, but I think what I mean is that you get the support also to help really guide you to obtain your goal, so that the incentive is not that you have to do it on your own, but that there is a team behind you that will help you to be successful.
Mm. Yeah.
More than that it's now, I think, at the moment.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And not only looking at research.
Yeah.
So that you get some choice yourself to see where are my strengths.
Exactly. Yeah.
But again, it should also fit with the objectives of the department. Because if you have 10 people that want to go for the educational career, maybe you don't need those in your department. And you have to have an honest conversation and say, sorry, I truly see that you have those skills, but within my department now, it's not available. And at least you get an honest answer, because many times we keep people hanging.
Yeah. And I think that is mentorship as well.
And leadership.
Yeah.
So that would be a great example, exactly. Guys, we need to close already.